This is All Chapped Up, where we push the limits and say what we want, how we want, while pulling your chain to bring you back for more of what you want. I'm Chris Chappell, a.k.a. Chappie, outcast of all types and genders. Welcome to Chappie Hour. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Scary Kids Scaring Kids, band that broke up about 7 years ago. Also, my next guest's favorite band. I found it only appropriate to play this song, kind of an inside joke, but you guys will find out tomorrow night on the show why, and you should be able to figure it out. Without further ado, please welcome my next guest. All right, welcome, welcome, welcome. This is All Chapped Up, Chappy Hour. And my guest today is none other than Riki Long from Lil Riki Fitness, also from American Grit Season 2. She was one of the cadres, my personal favorite. And I can say that because I haven't interviewed the other three yet. Nah, just kidding. No, no, seriously though, I really like the way she, you know, took her team and did it kind of the kind way instead of, you know, getting into them. And I think that actually works a little bit better. But anyways, without further ado, let me welcome Riki Long. How you doing, Riki?
Hi, I'm doing all right, especially for a Saturday. I'm due for a nap, but here I am, hard charging.
I just had a nap, so I'm actually feeling pretty energized.
Okay.
Yeah. You get one right after this, right? No. So let's talk a little bit about you. We'll talk about you, like your upbringing, and then, you know, joining the Marines, and then your company, and then maybe, you know, even talk a little bit about American Grit, your time on there so far, and you know, and then maybe we could talk about some of your ways on the way you do things, and then maybe we'll just have a little bit of fun too as well. So I guess the first thing people may want to know is, you know, where are you from? Where'd you start off at? And, you know, your childhood, did you have a pretty good childhood and stuff like that? So,
my childhood definitely wasn't, a common one, but again, what is common? Okay. Well, I was born in San Diego, California, and I pretty much like lived all over Southern California, from San Diego to Los Angeles. And then, my parents, actually my mother and father, they married each other twice. So I think once after I was born, and then the second time I was probably like 4 or 5 years old. And then finally they're like, you know what, this isn't working. And they divorced. I think I was about 8 years old. And, my mom remarried when I was about nine and a half. So I had two dads. I had my father and I had my stepdad, and I actually do call my stepdad dad. He did raise me at such a young age. And, I mean, he was around all my life, and he's the reason, or one of the reasons why I joined the Marine Corps. My stepdad was in the Marines. I had a nomadic lifestyle growing up. I've lived in North Carolina, back to California, to Missouri. So we've been everywhere. And I did ask my parents as soon as I got into high school, because I was sick of making new friends and not remembering anybody's names and just going from school to school to school. So I asked for high school, like, can I please like stay with my godparents, my mom's sister and brother-in-law? And so for high school, I like luckily stayed in one high school for all 4 years. And it was in Southern California, like in Orange County. You know, I was in honors classes. I was a cheerleader, water polo player, softball player. So I was very active, with school. And I also went to a performing arts academy. So in up to high school, you have to be either like in band, in dance, acting. So I chose theater. And so I did theater for 4 years. Didn't do anything with it. It's just a prerequisite. And, I was an editor-in-chief for the newspaper staff, and that's what I went to school for. So after graduating high school, I went to Cal State Fullerton for 2 years for communications with an emphasis in journalism. I was in a very toxic relationship at the time and just feeling so burnt out, so used, and I asked my mom and stepdad, who at this time were still living in St. Louis, because that's where my stepdad was recruiting out of, and so I asked him, I was like, you know what? I want to join the Marine Corps. Just please let me sign the papers. I need to get out of this toxic place. And I'll just finish school like while I'm in the Marines. And so my parents bought me a plane ticket from California to Missouri. And then I got shipped out to boot camp like 3 weeks later. And I did 4 years in the Marine Corps from 06 to 2010. And at first I went open contract, and like that's a scary thing, because open contract, you can be, you know, the chow hall cook, or you could be a mechanic, anything.
Right.
And
right.
And the only reason why I was able to do the open contract was because I had initially signed up for linguistics, and it was a $7,000 bonus, so I was so excited to like go into linguistics. It was going to be a 5-year contract. And it was the last job available, and I like passed the linguistics test, the D-Lab test. The job I like had stole it from, the girl was overweight, and that's why she couldn't go into boot camp. The day I went to MEPS to get shipped out to boot camp, that girl shows up 7 pounds lighter, and she made weight and took her job back. So I looked at my stepdad, and I was like, oh, so I guess I don't go this week. Like, I'm not going to ship out. I don't leave till 2 weeks from now with a different job, right? And he's like, nope, you already signed the contract and everything, you're leaving now. I'm like, but I don't have a contract. And he's like, well, now it's open-ended.
Oh my
God. So my stepdad screwed me. I was so pissed. I was crying like the whole flight. Yeah.
Man.
It was bad. Yeah, so.
I've never heard that before. That's crazy.
Yeah. I was like, you know what, my motto is always find a positive in every negative.
Right.
And so, I mean, I have 13 weeks in boot camp. Like, I can't really worry about this job right now. Like, let me just stick with boot camp. It's the type of training that I like. So I'm going to make the best of it and have some fun. And since I quit college I didn't have enough credits, like, even for an associate's yet, so I went in as a private to boot camp, and I kicked ass. I did my best. I did everything that I could. I listened and beyond. Like, I did what I had to in order to become a squad leader, so I got the position as a squad leader in boot camp, and since I graduated as a squad leader, I ended up getting a meritorious promotion, so I actually came out as an E2 from boot camp. From there, I was like, you know what, like, I'm just going to, like, keep, like, climbing the ranks, and that's all I'm going to do. And, like, let's see if I can let's see what kind of job I get. So, I mean, get out of boot camp, they issue you your MOS, your military occupation. And it was 0121, which is personnel administration. And I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, I'm going to be a secretary in the Marine Corps? Like, I was mad. Like, I'm doing linguistics. Yeah, I'm going to go overseas.
Billy Badass, the secretary.
Yeah, exactly. And I was like, oh my gosh, like, I don't want to be a paper pusher in the Marine Corps. Like, that's normally not why people sign up to join. And again, you know what? these are the cards I'm dealt with. I'm just going to make the best out of it and see what happens. So, and another thing. So I go to personnel administration school. I think it was like 6 weeks long. And they then tell you where your duty station is. Like from there, from your school, you go to your duty station immediately. Like you get a plane ticket and go. So one person dropped from our class. So the instructor, he cut this line out of the Marines. He cut this row off, but he forgot to cut this row, so it didn't shift correctly. And so instead of me, because like you get to pick your top three places that you want to go to. So I said West Coast, Overseas, then East Coast, because I really wanted to like still be back in California or somewhere near there, or I wanted to go to Japan. Or, and then East Coast would have been my last choice because East Coast is basically just Camp Lejeune. You'd be stuck in Jacksonville, North Carolina. So remember, he changed the names, but he forgot to change the locations. So instead of going to West Coast, where I should, I think my duty station was going to be Yuma, Arizona, which isn't great, but at least it's close to California. I ended up getting NCAS, New River Air Station, Jacksonville, North Carolina, which is the armpit of America. And
my
MOS school is right here in Camp Geiger, and all you do is take a 15-minute drive to MCS New River. So I didn't even have to get on a plane or anything. I just took a cab straight to my duty station immediately. And from there, like, I started my job. I hated it because since I was a new PFC and they didn't know who I was or couldn't to enter people's social security numbers on a computer, I was a filing clerk for like the first 2-3 months. And finally someone went on maternity leave. So they needed someone to like start entering numbers on the computer. And I was like, oh, let me try. I want to do it. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to steal this person's job. I'm going to be the best personnel clerk here, and I'm going to keep this job. And I did. And my OICs, he noticed that, like, I was a go-getter, and I was a hard worker. So he let me take care of the legal section. It was, like, legal. It was mostly legal, and, like, we would do some, like, human resources stuff, but mostly legal. And I ended up getting another meritorious promotion to corporal. So I think I got to corporal like after a year and a half enlisted, and he put me in charge. So I was the NCO, non-commissioned officer in charge of the legal section. So then my MOS basically became legal administration, and that's what I did for the rest of my time in the Marines. And I loved it. I loved working with the OICs, especially, just because I'm like with a little bit more mature people. I joined the Marine Corps when I was 20. So I already had that partying out of my system for the most part. And I think that's also why I got out of the Marines and only did my 4 years, was because I felt like a babysitter, because I dealt, like, especially in the legal section, I dealt with like the bad Marines, like the Marines that get NJPs and all that stuff. Like, I had to deal with them. So I just felt like a babysitter, because there's these 17 and 18 year olds coming in, joining the Marine Corps, and they've never experienced the college party lifestyle. So they're doing it now. Mm-hmm. And I also just didn't think, like, I was like, you know what, like, although I can probably change my MOS, it would take like a lot of work. And I was just like, I was already over it. And they put a bad taste in my mouth, the Marine Corps, but like, I was turned down so much. I put in a package twice to go overseas. I wanted to be part of the Lioness program, and I wouldn't say female infantry, but you are there and you are carrying overseas,
right.
And you're searching the female Muslim women, because you know they can't be touched by men. So I would be there for that, but my package got turned down twice because they told me that I became an asset. There's no one to do my job if I left, so they need me. And so I was just, I think it was kind of like, you know what?
I was going to say, isn't that the way like everything goes though? Like
It's funny that you say that because I was actually just so irritated yesterday because every time I go to work, somebody is not wanting to do their job as good as they can do. So it's always the person that, you know, even though you didn't really want to do it, you knew that it was your job, so you did the best you could. And because of that, it's almost like you got punished. It's the same thing with a lot of people, you know. I go out, I'm a truck driver, I go out and I run a route. Most guys have 3 stops, then they're done for the day. I end up getting 12 because I can get the stuff done. But I also work 14 hours in a day, and then I'm like, really? I get back, and, you know, it is frustrating, and that sucks for you that happened like that. So one thing I wanted to ask you, kind of back up a little bit, is did you go through, like, as a child growing up before you went in the military, did you go through any type of, like, strictness as far as, like, were you in a strict household to where, like, you know, you did what you were supposed to do, you didn't mess up, you know, and stuff like that, so that it kind of prepared you, because, I mean, not everybody, when they see boot camp, they see, you know, Full Metal Jacket and stuff like that, you know. Obviously, there are some parts of that are true, obviously. You know, some obviously aren't. But, I mean, it's still, you have to have tough skin in order to deal with it, you know. It's not just physical. It's even more mental.
Very mental. So, growing up, like, my father wasn't in the military at all. Like, he was in the movie industry, so he did lots of special effects, props, and puppeteering. But he was into physical fitness. I mean, he grew up as a swimmer, and he did performing arts. And, like, my grandmother put him in, like, tap dance and all that stuff. So he was, like, he was really physical. And so when I was young, my dad would, he would try to make physical fitness fun for me when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. And especially because on my mom's side of the family, heart disease and diabetes runs very, very badly on that side. So my dad was always afraid he didn't want us to ever be overweight or, you know, have those kinds of problems. So, like, he would tell me, like, hey, I bet you can't do 10 push-ups right now. I'm like, okay. And then so, like, you know, I'll do a push-up. So he'll make stuff like that fun. So, like, I've been doing push-ups since I was, like, 5 years old, and I've been doing pull-ups probably around the same age. And so, like, like the PFT that we have to do in the Marine Corps, like, it was cake for me. I would always get like a 300. As far as being strict, my godmother, the one that I lived with throughout my high school career, like, she was, she was your typical Catholic Mexican woman. Like you think, like, mean, you know, very strict. But
come,
like,
on over here. Come on. No, you stop.
Yeah. But like I appreciated that. It taught me a lot, and, like, I appreciate that discipline because, like, I feel like I would use that for my kids or, like, my nieces. But, yeah, like, so I wasn't allowed to have a job. I really wanted to have a job in high school so I can, like, pay for things. And she's like, no, your academics come first. So as long as you get, you know, A's and B's, make sure I had a clean house with my cousins and it was her two sons and me. We would have to clean house every Saturday in order for us to, like, go to the mall or anything. So, like, we start our day first, like, they'll wake us up. Like, they would wake us up at, like, 6, 7 in the morning. And I'm like, all right, you've had enough sleep. Let's get some breakfast. So she would make us a good breakfast, and then she'd give us, like, 2 to 3 hours to do our chores. And then she wouldn't give us money, but she would take us shopping or whatever. I'm like, all right, so what do you want to get? And then so I get to pick, like, an outfit or something, and then that was kind of my reward. So I like that. Like, I always woke up early, and I always did what I had to do, and that was actually one of my posts today, my Instagram post. I woke up at 5 this morning just because I don't like to waste the day, and I went outside to water my plants, and it's habit. And my stepdad, he used to just always, like, take us out, like, do, like, fun outdoorsy stuff. So when I got to boot camp, like, I loved it. There were people that, like, would freak out, like, the girls, and start crying or sob. Like, I did cry my first week in boot camp, but that was just because I missed my family. Like, I mean,
right.
That's normal, you know? Mm-hmm. But as far as, like, swim qual, rifle range, oh my gosh, I loved rifle range. I love to shoot shit, so that was fun. The crucible is basically like a simulated war, and we do that for a whole week. So we're, like, dressed in camis, we have our faces painted, they give us MREs to eat, like, we get, like, one MRE to eat, like, for the entire day or something like that. You sleep in your sleeping bags. Like, it was really fun. I enjoyed that.
Listen to this really closely, my nerd listeners who are gamer freaks, okay? The Crucible, the actual definition of Crucible, is a Marine being a badass. Not a little thing that you do on Destiny where you go and fight other people and see who can get the most kills, okay? It's legitimate badassery, okay? So it's getting out in the wilderness and seeing things and doing things and experiencing things. So, nothing against you guys, but I'm just saying, you know, if you think you're a badass by playing a video game, try and step in the shoes of a Marine or anybody else in the military for just one day, and you'll understand badassery. Sorry to interrupt you. One thing I want to kind of go back to is another thing that I think that a lot of the younger generation can kind of take respect to, and because a lot of them don't understand. Like, you basically said, okay, you wanted to get a job. Like, that was something you wanted to do, but you couldn't because your godmother said, hey, you know, get A's and B's. But see, she gave you a requisite. She says, you get A's and B's, you do your chores, you're a good person, you're a good kid, you get rewarded. See, it wasn't given to her. It was earned.
Yeah, that was my job.
Right, it was earned. So understand that, you know, this is why people turn out the way they turn out, in my personal opinion. When you're growing up and you're given everything and you take everything for granted and you wreck something, it doesn't matter because you didn't have to work for it. You know what I'm saying? And you don't have that idealistic approach of, hey, the government owes me college money or whatever it is. You know, they owe me free college. And you know what? I didn't get free college. I'm sure you didn't. I mean, you had to pay for some of it. We got GI Bill and stuff like that. But
yeah, I do.
Yeah, but I mean, still, I mean, even with the GI Bill, we earned it. Everything is still worked for it. Exactly. Yeah. So I just wanted to kind of put in there because on my podcast, I like to, you know, I'm not conservative or liberal, nor do I ever, you know, try to push that on anybody else. But I do like to just to be real, and I like to get the real person out of you, you know, because people see you on TV and they see you as this sweet little badass, which you are in real life. I mean, honestly, I mean, let's be completely honest. But as far as just life in general, you've actually been through life and appreciate it just like anybody else, no matter how much. If you're on this tier of life, if you're on this tier of life, you know, high or low, you, as long as you're doing the things you knew, it doesn't matter because, you know. So anyways, I go on a tangent sometimes about that kind of stuff, and I appreciate it. But we're about the same age, so I think that we can kind of understand where each other are coming from as far as that goes. And you know what I'm talking about when I say enabling and stuff like that.
Yeah. We didn't have iPads, so.
What is that? I still don't know what an iPad is. No. I'm kidding. No. Am I?
yeah, because I didn't get my first cell phone until I was 17 when I actually started driving. And I was only allowed to use the phone to let my family know, hey, I'm at my location, or hey, I'm on my way home.
Was it those big ones? Was it them big,
No, it was just the Nokia one.
Oh, yeah, yeah, with just little buttons on the front. That was my wife's first cell phone. That's hilarious.
Very cool.
So, okay, awesome, and good time in the military. Let's shift gears a little bit. Because I don't, unfortunately, probably don't have very much time as far as that goes. Because I don't want people to. This could be a 3-hour thing if we kept talking. But, so a lot of people, myself included, and I love tattoos. It is very, very therapeutic for me. And I never did. Let me go ahead and say that. Like I got one tattoo, and it was this small. It was basically it was a little spot on my shoulder. And anybody that's seen me, my shoulders aren't that big, so it was very small. It was Japanese letters. I got it when I was in the service, and it said crazy and insane, or at least so that's what I thought. I mean, it could have said something.
I think it is.
Yeah, exactly.
French fries.
I love chipoca. No, so it was that. And after that, I was just like, I got it because I thought, oh, it's cool to get a tattoo. Now, I didn't get the therapeutic side of it because it was just a small thing, and I didn't understand like what it was all about until I met my wife, and I got my first real tattoo, and it was like, wow, this is pretty intense. This is cool, you know? And I love it, you know? And my wife has got, I think, over 12, 13. And we've seen yours, and I mean, as a fan, I just kind of want to know, do you have one artist, or do you go to different artists, or do you have one specific artist that does your work?
Yeah, now I have one. I started when I was 18 getting tattoos. I'll be 31 next Sunday. So, like, I got my first, like, tattoo, like, on my flank, and it's just, like, a little shooting star, pretty lame. And then before I got into the Marine Corps, yeah, everybody has that lame tattoo.
Like a tramp stamp, oh!
Yeah. So I got a pirate ship right before I went into boot camp, and then my stepdad was like, all right, no more tattoos right now because, like, you're trying to get in the Marine Corps, and, like, you know, you have to put everything on record. And so I stopped for a little bit. Once I finally got to my duty station, I got my chest piece. Well, I started, like, little by little. And, like, if you could see, like, they're pretty faded.
Mm-hmm.
They've actually had 6 sessions of laser removal. I was in another bad relationship, and the guy didn't like tattoos, or they didn't belong, quotes. They didn't belong on women, so, according to him. And so I'm a people pleaser.
Women with tattoos are hot. I don't care what anybody says. And if you're going to argue with me, I'll take you down.
Totally.
And if I can't take you down, Riki will take you down. I promise you that. See the size of this girl's thighs. I'm telling you, she will take you down.
Yeah, so, like, after my 6th session, because getting your tattoos removed is a lot more painful than actually getting a tattoo. So, like, the healing process is really bad. So, after my 6th session, I was like, what am I doing? Like, this guy, like, why am I with him? And so, kick the dude to the curb. Stop getting the laser session. So now it's just, like, faded. Maybe in a year or so, like, I still have to think about if I want to just, like, redo them or just cover it completely with something. But this was, like, all one artist from North Carolina when I was in the Marines. And then now this is all one artist. So I have, like, lipstick with eyelash curler. I have a dagger through some donuts.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I have a huge sweet tooth. I have, globes, like, and that's pretty much, like, to remind myself, like, make sure you travel the world. Mm-hmm. Like, don't just, like, cause sometimes I do get stuck with my work and, like, I don't give myself time off. So this is just always a reminder, like, hey, like, leave New York for a little bit and, like, go have fun. So I have that. This is my dog, Boomer. She's a Frenchie.
Oh, that was gonna be my next question. Do you have any pets? That's very cool.
Yeah. That's my baby. I've had her for about 4 years now. And then this is the Cowardly Lion.
There's no place like home. Okay.
Yeah. The reason why I got that is my grandfather, my father's father, the ones that, like, put my dad in acting, like, theater and all, and dance and stuff. My grandpa was actually a performer in Las Vegas. Pretty much all he was in the Navy, and then he started just doing, like, Latin jazz and all that kind of stuff. And he and I used to always recite the play, The Wizard of Oz. So when he passed away, I got it. And it's also something that between me and my best friend, we got kind of like buddy tattoos. She has a Tin Man on hers because it's her favorite too. And then I actually have my moto tattoo right here. And I got it. I just got it like last year. Like,
oh, wow.
I've been out of the Marines for 7 years, and I just get my moto tattoo now.
Right. Yeah, I think my father's got the bulldog right here, bulldog, yeah. And he actually owns a bulldog, too. She's a sweetheart. Oh, my gosh. Well, that's cool. So you just have the one, Boomer, right? Is that the only pet you have? How about as far as you and your husband go, how long have you guys been married?
We've been married for 2 weeks now.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
very cool.
We've been married for 2 weeks, but we've been together for over 4.5 years.
Okay.
And
congratulations, by the way.
Thanks. We were trying so hard back in June to, like, plan. We're like, you know what? We're going to do a destination wedding because, like, we wanted something small anyway. And we're so busy. Like, he's busy. He owns a CrossFit gym, so he's busy relocating the gym because, like, we're going to get out of the lease to get another place and for the gym. And then, like, me with the show, like, I do have, like, interviews and podcasts and stuff, and even my own nutrition clients. Like, it was just so much work. So we would start planning and we get so overwhelmed after, like, just 20 minutes, and we're like, and just close the computer. And one day I was kind of joking, but kind of not. And I was like, hey, let's just elope. Like, let's just go to City Hall. And he was like, that's not a bad idea. Okay. So I called my mom because if I had eloped, like actually legit eloped, my mom would kill me because I only have one other sister and she did that when she was 19. And we didn't find out till like maybe 4 days later. So I called my mom like, hey, can you come July 7th? And she was like, yeah, why, what's up? And I was like, Dan and I are going to get married. Okay. So my parents came, my sister, my brother, and my best friend from Florida. And we did it. Got married at City Hall.
Very cool. Very cool indeed. You guys plan on having any kids down the road, or is the kids in the talks, or?
It's always been in the talks, definitely, because like we keep thinking, like, man, we would have like really jacked kids, you know, super athletic. He's a CrossFit Games athlete. Like, he's been to the CrossFit Games 4 times already.
Oh, sweet.
So like, yeah, and so we've always talked about it, and we would love to have our own family, but like, I'm a competitive weightlifter, and he also competes for his sport. Like, we're both sponsored athletes, and if we were to have kids, it probably wouldn't be for like another 4 to 5 years, I would say. Mm-hmm. And that would put us at like age 35, 36. But then we also think like, well, we're like really selfish people. Like, we enjoy our quiet time because we don't get much of it already, yeah, as it is, you know? And so, it just depends on the day. Like, we flip flop back and forth. Like, well, we could just get a second Frenchie, or maybe we can have a kid later down the line, or we've even considered adoption.
Very cool. Very cool indeed. So that brings me to, obviously my next question is, your company. What, obviously you love staying in fit. Your husband has his own company as well. So was that just kind of after you got out of the Marines, was it like, okay, I'm going to go get a 9-to-5 job or you know, whatever, or I'm going to start my own company? How did that all come about?
Okay. So when I got out of the Marine Corps, my plan was to use the GI Bill and go to school. And, while I was waiting for that to kick in, I did apply to become a GS at the Merchant Marine Academy, which is on Long Island. And so I was a GS6, and like, for people that don't know what that is, that's basically how would you explain that? Like, military ranking, but like, yeah, it's like a government job, but for civilians, basically. Yeah. So yeah, I was a GS6 for Merchant Marine Academy for about almost 2 years, while I was going to school. And I'm a Marine, and I was actually working for 2 Navy chaplains for the Merchant Marine Academy. And like, Navy and Marines, they work together. Like, it's under the same branch, I guess you would say. But, I don't know, something about those chaplains, they just rubbed me the wrong way, the way that they treated me. And I essentially hated my job. And I just thought to myself, like, I'm not supposed to be behind a desk for the rest of my life. This is not me. Like, this is me settling, and I don't want to settle. Mm-hmm. And I was dating Dan at the time, and he owns his CrossFit gym. And he was having problems at his gym because he had just lost 2 coaches because out of nowhere they told him, oh, by the way, we quit because we're opening our own gym. And so now, yeah, it was pretty shitty. And so Dan was like, well, I don't have any CrossFit coaches. And I had just gotten my level 1 for CrossFit. And he was like, what if I match what you get paid now at your job if you quit and work for me? And I'm like, sold. Like, you don't even have to ask me twice. Like, I'm gone and I will help you coach. Mm-hmm. So I started coaching CrossFit with him. I would do like the morning classes, and like, I like started to like realizing, I'm like, wow, I like this so much better, like training people like to get physically fit and not being behind a desk doing secretary work. And then, but then I started noticing that like, cause I would try different diets, like the paleo diet, Atkins, like I did everything. And a lot of the members would see me, and like, they would see my body change, like for the good, for bad, like worse, like everything. They just saw my body change. And then finally I found like a certain diet that I was like, this is my diet and I'm going to stick with it. And that's it. So like, members would be like, hey, Riki, like whatever it is you're doing, you think like if I paid you like $20 or something, like you could help me? And I'm like, okay. And so I would start running challenges, like fit challenges at my gym. I would charge like $20 a person just to give them like their certain macronutrients to follow. I'm like, all right, this is what you got to do, blah, blah, blah. I'd have like a little file for each and every one of them. And then like I started not doing my actual coaching job for CrossFit and doing more nutrition stuff. And Dan noticed that and he's like, well, you're not even working for me anymore. You're just like doing your own side gig. And I was like, yeah, I was like, I don't think this is going to work for us. I was like, I kind of quit. And, but like by then he had already had some more coaches.
Right.
So I became like the nutrition coach for CrossFit Lindy. And then I would just share it on Instagram because like, I'm proud of like what I've helped people do, you know? So, I only had like maybe 500 followers on my Instagram. So I would just post like, oh, look at so-and-so's before and after. And this person's before and after. And then like next thing I know, people from like around the world are like messaging me like, do you think you can help me? And then it just kind of boomed. And I just got like more and more, I don't know, noticed like more platform for it. And then I became like a professional weightlifter. And so my name just got a little bit bigger and bigger. And then the whole American Grit thing, that was kind of cool how it happened. And what John Kroll, the executive producer, told me was that the one of the producers from the first season was actually a fan of mine as a weightlifter. And he was like, hey, Riki has a YouTube and she was a Marine. Like, you might want to check her out and like maybe see if she would be a cadre. So...
Very cool. And we'll definitely get into that show here shortly. I definitely want to promote that as well. I think right now is the perfect time to do one of our segments that is brand new. Riki's going to be our first part of the segment. She'll be our first contestant, which is going to be quite fun. I think this could be fun. Now, keep in mind, we have already said Riki is married very happily. This is completely for fun, and we just like to do it just because it gives the guests a little time to kind of interact with their personality. So this is a segment we like to call the dating game. And now there'll be three gentlemen vowing for Riki Long's love, and... Now, she won't know who these contestants are until, you know, they actually say something to her. So, Riki, you have three questions. The first question you're going to ask, all three contestants will give you an answer. And then after the third question that you ask, you'll have a chance after everybody answers to decide which one kind of fits your, basically answers the questions best to your, you see what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So... contestant number one, please introduce yourself with just your name only. Like, whoa, dude! I think we know who that is. Riki? There was only supposed to be one person in that booth. I guess we'll get away with it, because, like, it's totally Scoob, dude. He's very harmless. Alright, we'll take it, we'll take it. Okay, so contestant number one. We got Shaggy. Contestant number two, please introduce yourself with just your name. Forrest Gump. Okay, well, that'll work. I guess Forrest is here. It's been a long time since Jenny passed. I guess it's okay to move on. All right. And then we got contestant number three, are you there? Contestant number three.
Where'd he go?
Oh, Elmo. Hey, what's going on, Elmo? How's it going, bud? All right. Well, we have three contestants for you. Riki, go ahead and ask your first question to whichever contestant you want to, and they'll answer for you.
Okay. Let's do... Forrest, describe our first date.
Well, Riki, I reckon I would take you down to Bubba Gump's Rep and show you my business. It's a business that's been around for about 7 years, but I'd have to really try hard not to call you Jenny, because she really is the only one that had my heart. I mean, we went together like peas and carrots, but I would definitely take you out for a nice meal, and then we go running for a long time, probably keep running, than running.
Okay, okay, very good, Voris. I think we got it, man. You'll be going running and taking Riki out for dinner. All right, Riki, go ahead and ask your second question to whichever contestant you would like.
All right. Let's see. How about Elmo? This might be a good question for you. If you were an ice cream flavor, what would you be and why?
Well, I guess I'd be, cotton candy. Because it's so good.
Good answer.
Okay, cotton candy. That's good. Let's go ahead and, third and final question. Obviously, this is going to be for Shag and Scooby.
All right. I like both series of these books, but I want you to pick Twilight or Hunger Games, and do explain why.
Totally Twilight, because, I mean, we're into haunted stuff, man. I mean, the mystery machine. We go inside the van and we smoke pot.
Scooby Snacks, Shaggy.
Like, yeah, man, Scooby Snacks. And then we see ghosts. So, of course, vampires. I mean, vampires. Scoob.
Okay, well, looks like we got a three answers from three very competitive contestants. Now is the time when Riki gets to pick the one that definitely suits her her needs.
Right. Well, first, it was definitely between two, so I will have to definitely say goodbye to Forrest because I am not a runner. I'm not very much of an endurance athlete, so I'm sorry, Forrest. I have to say goodbye.
That's okay. I probably couldn't have loved you like Jenny anyway. I may be stupid, but I know what love is. Thank you for your time. See you later, Forrest. Have a good day, buddy.
And, I think I'm going to have to say goodbye to Elmo, too, because I would kind of feel like a pedophile if we went on a date. So... yeah, Shaggy and Scoob. I mean, I love dogs, so let's go, Shaggy.
Like, whoa, dude, that's totally cool. She's so smoking, man.
Whoa, 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 easy there, man. You haven't even taken on her first date. Reggie?
Well, thanks, and join us next time, tomorrow, when Janessa Morgan decides out of three very, very eligible bachelors. All right. Now, I'm glad that was fun. That was fun. Now, let's go ahead and get on into the nitty-gritty, no pun intended. American Grit. A couple questions I have for you. Obviously, you kind of gave us a little lead into, you know, how you got the position as a cadre, which is really cool. Definitely has to be an honor for you. I mean, to represent like that, for sure. Hell, I would love to do it. I just got to get back in fit, but... you came across in the first episode as basically saying, I mean, you put it out there. You says, look, obviously John Burke's the hard ass that wants to kind of, you know, go, and that's fine. Everybody's got their ways to learn. You know, Grady was kind of, in my opinion, he was kind of a little bit of both. He was kind of friendly with you, but he was mischievous too. But he was also, if he had to be, he would be a hard ass if he needed to be. But I could be wrong. Maybe down the road you will, but he hasn't really brought that side of him out yet as far as the show goes. Sure. Maybe him and Burke kind of going back and forth, but not with the contestants he hasn't. Which he hasn't really had a reason to. I mean, they've been pretty dominant so far. So, you know, maybe if he was maybe in your position, say, or Chloe's position, I think maybe he would, he may be a little more angry and show his bad side.
Totally. Yeah, I think so.
But anyway, regardless, in my aspect, I mean, I was in the military as well. And, I mean, I took the yelling and stuff like that, like a grain of salt. Cause I mean, I was used to it when I was growing up, no big deal. So, but for some people, it doesn't work like that. To me, in my opinion, I think everybody responds to nice. Everybody does. Yeah. I mean, But only some people respond to yelling at their face and talking down to them.
100%.
You know, so I really appreciated that point of view, and I know a lot of fans did too. I think that's why, you know, you're kind of a fan favorite as far as cadre goes. Right. One thing I did notice that kind of, and it drove me nuts too, even though you want to be so nice, but like in the second or third episode, you were having issues with Carla. You know, because anybody that's anybody, and all my veteran listeners today knows, one of the most important things that we do is be on time. Like, you aren't late in the military, and you learn that throughout your life. You are always on time. I guarantee you ask any veteran that has a day job, you ask that person's boss, that person has never been late. Matter of fact, he's probably been 20, 30, or she's probably been 20, 30 minutes early, just because that's just ingrained and instilled in us. So when you're trying to train other people like Riki was, and seeing that she was more concerned about the way she was looking rather than going out and kicking ass, even though Carla, let me go ahead and say, has been kicking ass.
Totally, yeah.
But, I mean, there's a fine line there. So, obviously, you know, as a coach, you want to make sure that you're taken seriously, basically. And when you kept saying be on time, and it wasn't, it was almost like she was, you know.
Walking for me.
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, that's definitely like, I was definitely taking the friend approach with everybody at first, but Carla, man, she was just, it was the whole give an inch, take a foot or whatever. It was just too much. And like now when I watch the show and like actually see it, I'm like, man, I should have like grabbed her makeup and like thrown it in like Gator Lake or something.
Me and my wife said the same thing. It's like, why didn't she just take her makeup and go in there and be like, hey, get your ass up and let's go.
So I think it turns on a little more like as every episode progresses. Like she just gets more and more on my nerves, and I start to see, I mean, 10 weeks with someone, like if like with that kind of change, I mean, she's a 26-year-old woman, and I need more than just 10 weeks to like get to somebody, you know, especially someone like her. She's so stubborn and is so set in her own ways, and she's always been the leader. She's always been the one like calling the shots for everything. I mean, I think she said she had like 10 nieces and nephews that she helped raise because her own siblings weren't there. Like, that's one thing that I wish American Grit, like the editing part, like they would show more of, is like their stories. Because even though Carla is very hard-headed and a lot of people don't like how she's treating me, I guess you would say, there's a reason. And like, so I think that's why, like, I, not that I let her walk all over me, but I was a little bit easier on her than maybe most would be. It's just because I know where she was coming from. I mean, it was just like her, like in a small little trailer, and she is a smart girl, and she was really nice. Like that one elimination where she shushed me, she started talking to me like maybe 10 minutes afterwards. So like we were having conversations. So I mean, she's not as evil as people think.
You know, it's an age thing though. I mean, we've already discussed that. It's, you know, we're in our 30s and she's still partying and stuff like that. So it's different. But there's two. Even though American Grit kind of is supposed to bring out the real you, there's obviously more to it. There's that, and we see that. I think as fans, we see that. We see that, okay, we understand that in order to get quote-unquote viewers, right, you have to kind of do that kind of stuff and not show us fans everything because, you know, It wouldn't be any, everybody would just lose interest. And it is, you're right. Sometimes it's not fair to you guys because you're getting kind of a bad rap, or she's getting a bad rap when you don't really know the whole story. I believe though that's what this is for. That's what these one-on-ones, you know, so that we can, I think that's what's good here. And that's why I want to get, you know, people on my show. And that's basically what I stand for. I stand for people that, either are getting kind of the wrong impression, but we're all people, man. We all shit the same. We all piss the same. We all smell the same. If we don't take a shower, it's all the same. You know, it don't matter if your paycheck is up here or it's down here. We're all the same. We're all the same. Love each other. That's the basis of this podcast, man. It doesn't matter if you're, like I say, it doesn't matter if you're a dude, a chick with a dick, dude with tits. it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you like dudes. It doesn't matter if you like girls. It doesn't matter. Everybody is people, and we just need a lot more togetherness. And I think that's very important. But any kind of teasers that you want to give us for this Sunday? I mean, obviously, stuff that's already been talked about, because I don't want you to get in trouble with Fox or anything. But
Well, it is... Tables will turn even more. I don't know if you've seen, like, the promo pictures yet that just came out last night, but they're, one of the promo pictures is of me jumping into the water, the freezing cold water. I'm fully clothed. I mean, I did take off my shoes, and that's because the reason why I took off my shoes before I jumped in is because I know wardrobe would get mad at me if I ruined those beautiful Adidas that they got me. And I think I did. I also had Chloe take off my mic because we do have waterproof mics, but that the one that I was wearing, like, I mean, they weren't expecting me to jump in the water, so I had a normal mic on. So I made sure to take that off too because I know those are expensive. But yeah, so I jumped in the water and for all for good reason. It's going to be an interesting team challenge. We'll say that.
Yeah, we got to see a little bit of some shocked faces that may or may not have been because you jumped in the water. Who knows? It looks like we see Hannah get pretty upset with somebody. I'm looking forward to seeing that. What I'm really looking forward to, and I'm so glad Janessa is willing to do this, and you should check it out too if you can. Janessa is going to be live with me tomorrow at 7 p.m. before it airs on here, Sunday it airs. So she's going to kind of go over her elimination, you know, and stuff like that. Then we're going to have a little conversation during the show. And then after the show, she's going to give us her reaction to whoever gets eliminated that week.
Oh, cool.
Right, so it's going to be pretty exciting. And that was completely all her idea. Great promoting, I think. But, yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be our first live show, which I'm a little nervous about, but I think we'll nail it. But as far as sponsors go, you say you have sponsors as a weightlifter. Who are your sponsors? Do you want to give a little plug there?
I am – okay, my first sponsor, it's my longest sponsor. I've been with them for almost 3 years, is Donuts and Deadlifts. It's an apparel company. And – I mean, it's that's the motto. We like to eat, lift, live. So donuts and deadlifts. I mean, who doesn't like donuts? And deadlifts are pretty cool. So yeah, they're my apparel sponsor, and I have a supplement sponsor called Integrity Driven Nutrition. John Burke, he's actually sponsored by them too. He's the one that got me the sponsorship. He got me in touch with the owner, and cool. It's veteran owned. Yeah, so it's pretty awesome. So we work together with that.
So, see, everybody, John Burke is not the asshole he seems online. He's actually a decent person.
No, he is.
And I will say this, he's very, very, very hard up on making sure veterans are taken care of. If you follow him on Twitter.
Yeah.
And he knows what he's talking about because I've been down that road with the VA as well. So, definitely, you know, like I said before, don't just take whatever you see on TV with a grain of salt. A lot of it just has to do with the show.
He's a very controversial person because he knows it, like media loves it. We all love it. No, but he really is a good person. He's annoying, but it's like a brother. It's like having a brother. He's annoying, but you love him.
Right, little noogie. You're like, come on. I love that picture of you behind him just giving him a choke.
Yeah.
That was great. That was good stuff. Good stuff.
But yeah, so my apparel, my supplement. I also have a skincare sponsorship.
Oh, they're sweet.
Called, yeah. Fula Skincare, it's probiotics, because like the doctor that created the brand, she always said, like, we always tell people to eat good, like eat good foods and whole foods. Why don't we put it on the skin? Like, the skin's the largest organ on our body, so let's put some probiotics on our faces. So I'm sponsored by them as well, and really good products. And if anybody is interested in any of my sponsors, just go to my Instagram. At @LIL_Riki, RIKI _. And if you look at my bio, everything's
awesome. Awesome. Real quick, if you don't mind, I would love to talk about your company. Sure. I would love to talk about some things that that you offer. I do know if you go to Lil Riki Fitness, LIL RIKI FITNESS.com, That is Riki's website. That's her company. There's, I want to say, if I could be wrong here, is there three or four different types of packages they can get?
There's three different types of packages. The fourth one is just like a re-up, like if someone needs a quick modification or something. But there's three main packages. One is a macro setup. And the way I teach nutrition to my clients is using the flexible dieting method. And it's basically like a little more difficult version of the Atkins diet. You're counting your macronutrients, which are your proteins, fats, and carbs. And basically, so I do like a big formula based on activity level, weight, height, age, even what they do for a living as far as work goes. And it's like a big formula, and then I give them, all right, you need this many proteins, fats, carbs. And that's basic macro setup. Then we do the remote coaching. That's the second package. I give you the basic macros, but then I coach them weekly, and that makes them check in with me weekly. And they also have my text me whenever they have questions. I sometimes clients are like, hey, I'm going to go out and have pizza at this place, but there's no chain restaurant, so I don't know what the macros are. How do I figure it out? So that's what I'm there for, one-on-one coach. And then my final package is my most expensive package. It's $300 a month, but it's because it's really serious work, and I do the work. They do nothing. They just eat what I tell them, and that's it. Like, so I will go in, I will tell them, all right, you're having this for breakfast, this for lunch, this for dinner, here are your snacks. And it's not like a tough diet. It's not like a pro diet, like, oh, you can eat chicken, rice, and broccoli. I'll ask them, like, to listen, like, what are your favorite foods? If someone told me, I need beers every single night just so I don't have any days or I don't binge, then I give it to them. I will give them their Oreo every single night if they need.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
I definitely want to, and I think we talked about this before after the show's over today. If you have, like, 5 minutes, I want to talk to you about some options for me and my wife as well. But yeah, definitely check that out, everybody. I mean, amazing, amazing process, amazing, amazing person. And I mean, she's all about helping people. So definitely, definitely check that out. So yeah, I just want to say thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Yeah, having me.
I had a lot of fun. I hope you did too. And got to know a lot about you. I plan on doing, and if you're up for it, I plan on doing, after the show is done airing and we find out, I plan on doing kind of like a rehash, maybe get a bunch of people on at once. If you would like to do that, that would be awesome.
Sure. Oh, yeah, that'd be cool.
Very cool. Very cool. And thanks a lot, man.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, very cool.
All right, we're going to end this podcast with a little Opeth, Ghost of Perdition. Enjoy and bang that head.
the shelf, I told you what's the one. We're open to the rumors that you have to live before you die young.
Yeah. to see you.